Welcome to the Leaderonomics Show. I'm with Dato CM Vignaesvaran, the CEO of HRDF. Dato Vignaesvaran, very nice to have you here in our show.
Nice to have you too.
You know, I'm very interested. You have such a diverse background. I mean, you started in Job Street, I think, or even earlier, and you had a couple of sales roles.
Yes, right.
Tell us a bit about your background and how you transitioned from sales to different functions to now leading the HR function somewhat. You know?
Okay. I should start back from my alma mater, like primary school.
Primary school, okay, primary school. Good.
So I studied in Pasar Road School. After that, I went to Cochrane.
Oh, that was a gangster school.
Yeah. After that, I went to Cochrane. So after Cochrane, I went to UKM. So I did my degree in marketing. Business head specialized in marketing. So when I started my first job, it was with my uncle. So it was a construction company. They had a project in KLIA, KLCC, Sungai Udang Refinery, Bukit Segari Power Plant and stuff like that. These guys had diverse projects. So I was with them for 2 years, doing everything, like one leg kick all. So it was, it was my uncle's company. So I had to involve in everything from purchasing to admin to finance to HR to...
But it's a great way to learn about business.
Exactly. So that's the thing. But this attitude of mine to do everything what we can do started with my father, actually, parents. Because young time, I used to work in my father's stall. We used to have a nasi lemak roti canai stall.
Okay.
So schooling time, I will go to the stall first. My father will wake me up around 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning. So I had to go down, do roti canai. Before I go to school, then come back, I have to help back in the stall or restaurants. So school holidays and the Chinese New Year holiday, Hari Raya holidays are the most dreadful time in my life, because that time the business will triple or quadruple and I have to spend more time over there. So I cannot be with other kids, no, playing around. But it really molded my character.
Also, you learn a lot, even the fundamentals of business very early on.
Very early on. So exactly. So we started with that, then the stall became a restaurant, then we owned a couple of restaurants. Even after I entered university and until I started working also, I used to go back to my restaurants and work there, actually. So I always tell my staff, jokingly, I say, I resign, I want to go back, I want to do roti canai, mee goreng, I think I can earn better living than working for...
Less stress living,
I mean, control our own life. So after the stint with my uncle, then I was jobless for a while. So it was a good learning curve for me also, because he was a millionaire. 2 years later, he became a bankrupt.
Oh, really? So that's how everyone lost their jobs?
It was a roller coaster. So all of us, the company had to shut down and stuff like that. And then I was looking for a job, and that time was the 97-98 crisis, where jobs were scarce and stuff like that. And so the first job offer I got after a 2 months break, not so break, I mean, no job, so I had to sit at home, was a sales job.
Okay.
So sales job. So I picked up the sales job, then I joined them.
This was with...
With Inchcape.
Okay.
Selling... photocopier machines called Gestetner.
Okay, so, and that was not a very popular.
Yeah, it was never a photocopier brand. It was one of the bottom brands at that point of time. And what happened? And being a sales guy in a so-called Indian environment is not so cool. You go to weddings, people ask you what you're doing. Then is it doing sales? Then they will look at you one kind. You degree holder or you know? So, but we did that. But I did quite well actually. So I was good in sales. One thing good what happened in Inchcape was they sent me for a lot of trainings. So when I entered there, they gave me a 1 month stint in the classroom. So they brought the copier there, they taught me how to do sales, how to do negotiation skills, how do you read people, how do you back off from things and stuff like that. So they teach you that whole works of how do you handle sales and marketing, a bit of more on sales, more on skills and selling skills and negotiation skills, those kind of things.
Also how to take care of rejection and all.
Yes. So it really gave me. So my manager at that point of time was Brian Lim. So I considered him as my guru for my corporate life. So he gave me a tough time. You know, he will scold you, he will do all kind of nonsense just to make you toughen you up. So at the end of the 1 month stint, he called us up, then he gave us a prep talk, then he said, you know why I was being such a bad guy with you all? Because this is what you will face outside world. So when you go outside, you have seen everything. So you won't. So that really built some character within us. So started with that, then after Inchcape, I moved to After Inchcape, I went to Sharp.
Okay. But in Inchcape, were there challenging times, or were there some? I mean, one lesson you learn is definitely the rejection and handling sales and how do you drive that. But were there any other fundamental lessons that you learned there?
I think one of the most important lessons I learned there was helping each other. So I was doing sales for 3 months. I didn't have sales. No sales at all. So being sales, they pressure you. I mean, to break the egg. So first month was no sales. Second was no sales. So third month we have a big board where they put all the dots. Like we have a sale, they will put a dot there. So mine was empty. You know. So the first break came to me was by this sales guy called Hao Tateng. So what he did, he called me up. He said, "Vix, what I'll do? I give you one of my sales to you. It was a small machine." He said, "I give you one of the sales, so I let you to..."
Well, he must have liked you to do that. So obviously, you were a likable person.
In a way. So he helped me out, so he gave me a machine. So I took the sales. He took a lot of rap for it, no, because when he gave me that machine, sales of the machine, the supervisor was not happy. So he was complaining, "Why did you give this guy a machine? Because out of my territory," those kind of things. But he said no. He stood by it. He said, "I'll help you grow." So that first sale of machine, 2 weeks later, I got almost 40 over machines I sold.
Wow.
So, but that first break gave me a lot of confidence. So, now in working life, after become CEO of HRDF, so I believe in building people. That's very important. So, you nurture them, even though they're going through a rough patch or they're going through a dry spell, I mean, in work or whatever is it. So, you nurture them, you give them proper support. We see whether they can fit into our environment and grow here. If they really cannot grow after you do all these things, then maybe their rice bowl is not here. They need to go somewhere else to
But that's it. A beautiful story, because if he didn't give you that sale, potentially you would have left, or you would have been asked to leave.
And yeah, to leave.
It'd be a very different story. Yeah.
Exactly. So he's one of the guys who gave me a break in my life, I can say that. So from there, I moved to Sharp. I was in a Sharp environment for almost 9 years, eight plus years.
Sharp, the TV and...
Again, there was I was selling copier. But my boss called me up. He said, "You got good interpersonal skills. At the same time, I'm very good in IT." So in university days, I used to sell, assemble computers and sell them. So I do a bit of programming. People talk about local degrees being not so useful, but I will disagree with that. When I was doing business ed in UKM, they actually forced me to do programming languages. So I know how to do C programming. I know a bit of Foxtran. I can do a bit of COBOL, and I picked it up over there. So that gave me a lot of interest in networking also. So I did my Microsoft Certified Programmer certification. Then after that, I became a network engineer. I started managing my network team. So my boss said, "You do technical sales." So I started selling higher volume machines, 120 machines, 80 machines. I became that high volume specialist type of guy. After working there for 8 years, then my boss moved. When my boss moved, I felt that I'm no more comfortable working there. So I moved to Sapura. So I was in Sapura for a year. Doing a bit, then I didn't find it didn't fit my soul. Then I moved to Job Street. So Job Street is another break I got.
So Job Street was just a couple years in, right?
Or
just started,
2 years,
right?
Only 2 years, yeah, yeah. Two years plus.
They had just started,
No. That time they already long time already. When I went in there, Suresh was there, Mark was there. Of course, all the other guy, Greg, all of them were Simon C, the marketing guy. So he hired me. So there, I got a lot of lessons about how do you run a unit by myself. So I was running this marketing unit. I still remember. So they gave me no budget. So that time, I still remember this Eric came and told me, he said, "Vix, you don't have money, but you have to market the product. I don't care how you do it."
Okay.
So that's where we started exchanging things. So we said, we give you airtime. We give you your banner time. We try to sell whatever we have, you know, our products that we have. Then we exchange it with other people. So you give us a seat or we promote your product for you or those kind of things. So we ran. And interesting enough, that time I had son who was under me, a guy called Sun. We ran almost, like I would say, easily around 40 over events a year.
Just once a week, almost.
Yeah, almost once a week without any money.
Okay. So we're gonna take a quick break right now, and we're gonna come back again to learn a little bit more about what happened in Job Street and some of the insights that you can help share with us that you learned at Job Street. We are here on the Leaderonomics Show. We're gonna take a quick break and we'll be right back here. Welcome back to the Leaderonomics Show. I'm with Dato CM Vignaesvaran from HRDF. Dato Vignaesvaran, you know, you're talking about Job Street and how you transitioned there. Tell us some of your lessons learned while you were there, because it was a startup or a couple of years in, growing very fast, lots of exciting things, and you're running 40 events a year. Tell us some of the challenges you had and some of the lessons that you learned and that you still are thankful for, I guess.
I think one of the biggest lesson learned in Job Street was numbers crunching. So everything that we presented to the bosses, we need to justify with numbers. So it's not like you plug in the air, you go in with a concept and sell them a concept. Of course, they will like the concept, but they want to know how did you derive with the concept. And after the concept has been given to them, then they want to quantify what is the result you can get from the concept that you sell to them. So when you are planning to do a program or a marketing plan or something like that, or you want to do a product or a promotion, you need to have all this done before we can get it approved. So that's something very new for me. Sincerely, when I was in Sharp, I tried to explain a bit, you know, do some mumbo jumbo and stuff like that. I usually can get things done. But with Job Street guys, I couldn't get it done that way. So they wanted to see numbers. And they really want to know what is your tracking, how do you do tracking, how do you do A-B testing, those kind of things. I really picked it up from Job Street. So add more structure into, and also the way they think. And when I entered Job Street also, one of the things I saw differently was how I don't know whether I call it Americanized kind of working environment. So it's more relaxed, but it's more target oriented. And you are given a task, so as long as you complete the task, you're okay. You know, those kind of things that I think it was very different compared to the Japanese company, because Japanese was very structured. Yep. They give you things and you need to do it that way and no other way about it. But with Mark and Suresh and stuff like that, we can argue, we can pitch ideas. You know, they always do this thing, they always have this interaction within the staff. So another thing I picked up from Mark is how to be humble, no matter how successful are you.
That's true. I think, and he still is. Right?
He still is.
Even though he's a billionaire, he's still in his shorts. And
exactly. So, he was a different kind of boss, but he interacts very well with the staff. And I think in his mind, we are all his friends, friends who actually work for him or something like that. So I think that kind of perception that he picked up. So now when I deal with my staff also, I do it that way. So I always encourage them to speak up. That's something that that I think is very important for an organization, for the staff to speak up. It could be from the bottom staff all the way to the top. So you need them to speak up to you, because if they know, because no means the information will be filtered. No? So you have this guy down here who goes to the boss, then by the boss finds a free time to tell you or to tell his boss and comes to you, it will be obsolete really, the information. With the speed of things moving around, we need information fast. So if the staff is comfortable enough to talk to you, if he cannot not necessarily go through his boss or something like that, then he can come directly to talk to us. So that part, I think I picked it up a lot from Job Street.
So from Job Street, then you transitioned to
HRDF.
HRDF. So how did that, from a high-tech startup to a government agency, what happened there?
I think the HRDF was hiring. And I always have this thingy with Suresh, so we always have this argument and talking. Suresh said, why don't you try this thing? They are looking for someone. So he said, you try it out. If you're not comfortable, then you can always come back to Job Street. So I said, okay. I attended the interview. I still remember I got 9 people who attended the interview for the job which I was going. And people interviewed me, and Dato Ame was the CEO then. He and Haji Gauss is the rep from the Polytechnic. So both of them liked me, they hired me. So it was simple as that. So when I went in, I really came in with a skeptical mind. Skeptical and also hopeful mind. Skeptical in the sense of, you know, government organization. Hopeful in the sense of, no lepak, no work, relax.
I thought hopeful in the sense that I can make a difference.
No. That was my mindset. You come in, government organization.
And
you know,
this was many years ago, right?
This was around 7 years ago. 7 to 8 years ago. Okay. So, but when I came in, I find the reverse. The staff were fantastic. They already being trained to work on a certain level of efficiency. And I found that HRDF was a policy-making body, government agency. We are private, but at the same time, we are connected to the government, quasi-government, some people would say. And work was tough. I actually went back home late. I used to work Saturday, Sunday. throughout. So most of the time we will leave office by 8-9 o'clock. The 7 days a week working day. So you work most of the time and stuff like that. So it's totally a different perception from what people perceive as what a government servant do. Mm. So I always tell my friends out there, like, they say, yeah, goyang kaki lah. I say, come lah, you join us and see. So you will understand.
Interesting. I mean, the perception you had coming in and the reality
is totally different. Yeah, it's totally different. So again, I understood that the government decision making is much more complex than what we do in corporates, because you need to consider a lot of things. Before a decision is made to roll out certain plans and stuff like that, there's a lot of study being done. You get grilled in a lot of many levels, and DASA, all these things will come in. And so it was an eye-opener for me. So it is not easy to make decision in government, because you've got a lot of stakeholders that right. you need to convince. In private sector, you just convince your boss. That's about it. You don't have to bother about the public or the other stakeholders or bigger bosses in the government or stuff like that. You just convince your boss and it's done. So over here, we had more stakeholders to convince. And more often, the skills I learned in Inchcape, Sharp, and stuff like that comes to play into that. That means, of course, I had a better presentation skills. I could talk better than most of the people here at that point of time. And it really helped me to grow and sell my ideas better, because I was a salesman. So I always look for cues, like whether this person like my idea or not. If I don't like my idea, then how do I tweak so I can present my idea a bit more different to suit that guy? I think that helped me to push a lot of new things. Mm.
But you talk about some of these challenges, mm. like especially the stakeholders. I mean, I can imagine, right? Mm. Just putting myself in your shoes, right? That you have the public who have a perception, you have the training community, you yes, have right. the companies, you have government, you have, even in government, there's probably many agencies that yes, right. all tussle for different turfs and so yeah. on and so forth. How do you stay motivated and somewhat stayed focused towards trying to achieve the goals that you set up for the organization?
So when we moved into HRDF, when I started working here, I realized one thing. The decisions we make in HRDF can determine the future of Malaysia. That is something that immediately came to my attention. I mean, something that I realized. So because we will decide on what kind of trainings do we want to give for the skills for the future.
So the competence of our nation is okay, in your hands.
In a way, it's in our hands. So when I looked at it, so that is one of the most motivating factors. So what we did was we did a lot of study. We did in HRDF already built, there was a lot of introspective studies. So we always do a study about ourselves to see whether we're being efficient or not, whether our funds are being distributed correctly or not, whether the KPI is met or not, whether the output is correct or not. So we were talking about it 8 years ago already, all these things within HRDF, the environment of HRDF. So when I came in, I realized that all these things are important and what we are going to do for the nation is right. So even I get a lot of hammering because a lot of policy changes that I'm trying to bring in, a lot of structure changes we are going to bring in with HRDF, especially towards the funding policy and stuff like that. So one thing that make me really steadfast and really ground me well is this thing that whatever I'm doing is for the good of the nation. So that has been an anchoring point for me. That's what drives me, actually. So no matter how much bashing I get, no matter how much people think that this is right or wrong, whatever is it, so my true north is there. Yeah, so I just go for it. I just go for it.
So, okay, we're going to take another quick break and we're going to come back and talk about the finals, in the final segment, the transformative leader, Dato Wicks, and some of the things that he did in terms of transforming HRDF. We'll be right back here on the Leaderonomics Show. Welcome back to the Leaderonomics Show. I'm here with Dato CM Vignaesvaran of HRDF, and we are having an engaging conversation on HRDF, on his life, and the journey that has taken him thus far. And now you're in this position to transform a very strategic entity in Malaysia, the HRDF, right? Because like you said, the competence of our country highly depends on the policies and the work that you and your team does. So when you first came to HRDF as an employee and later as you moved the ranks to become CEO, and when you first took the role as CEO, I'm sure you must have looked and said, there are things I need to do. Yep. You know, there's changes that I need to implement. There's a true north or the vision that I need to execute on. Tell us a bit about that journey and, you know, what transpired and what that true north was and how you're going about making those changes today.
The first thing I did was I looked at our own staff level. So at that point of time, we were underpaid. We were even paid lower than the government scheme. That was our peer level. So first thing was I fought about that. So I took it to the board, and the board agreed with me. We transformed the salary structure and the way we look at compensation and benefit. First thing we did. I mooted that, and that was going on. The second thing I did was I called everyone to the room, into the hall. So we had 100 over staff that time. I put them there. So I said, if you want me to transform, which don't involve a lot of money, what do you want me to do? So they listed 40 over things. I still remember they listed 40 over things. So I said, I can give you only three. Choose three. So the first top came in was they wanted a dress down Friday. So hence, the dress down Friday was rolled out in HRDF. Second, they wanted more healthy lifestyle. So they were talking about, because they spend a lot of hours here, you sit on the couch all the time or on a chair, you do a lot of work on your PC. In fact, some of my clerks have this carpal tunnel syndrome where because of repetitive work and stuff like that. So they were talking about how can we create a healthy life. So I told them, okay, we started giving free fruits or healthy snacks on Mondays. So my vision is one day to have a big bar of fruits. The second step now we're going to implement is we're going to prepare a few baskets of fruits for the staff first, so they can come and pick up and they can eat. So we're going to do that. And we gave them a free, not a free membership, we told them that we will subsidize their gym membership. So we said any gym you join, we'll give you 100 ringgit voucher for a month, and that will be subsidized by us. So these two things, we made the change. Of course, third, they wanted a free Wi-Fi, which I said no. We cannot clog our Wi-Fi system. But after we started engaging, we started having a lot of town halls. We give a lot of freedom for the guys to talk. In fact, the dress down Friday, we had a lot of argument. One group from the older generation said, no, we don't want a dress down Friday. Then hammer. Then they say, okay, we agree on a dress down Friday, but you must follow the rules. They say you cannot wear collarless T-shirt, so you need to wear this and stuff like that. So we came to a lot of compromise. So after the staff being, they started engaging, they see a different kind of leadership, and also maybe the time is right for those kind of leadership, very engaging leadership. We have a session, what we call a JCC, Joint Consultative Council, with the lower rank of staff. Because most of the time, managers, executives, we interact a lot because they come for work, meetings and stuff like that. But the lower rank staff, the clerical staff, maybe they don't have much opportunity to see the CEO. So we decided to have, it was already there, so we re-engage it back. So we have an engagement session, we always talk to them, ask them what they need. And another thing what I did was, before confirming any staff, I will want to see them first. So they'll come to the room, they'll just sit down, I'll just have a...
So it's just connect for you to connect with
connect them. Connect with them, and we need to know. So these are the few first...
So essentially you did a lot of work internally first. Yes. I mean, that's the first really, because I'm sure when you raised their salaries, there was a lot of joy and affiliation, you know, to you to some extent, and then you gave some of their requests, and finally you bond with them. Those clearly are very strong leadership pieces.
We did, but what I did also, when I did the salary increase, I put some jobs on contract also.
Okay.
So I told them, you need to be performance driven. Okay. We are going to pay you.
So you set in stone the high performance organization.
High performance organization. So we started pushing that particular.
So this was internal. What was done externally? I mean, in terms of the vision, in terms of driving the change, in terms of.
So externally, again, for external change, we looked back at ourselves. So we had this data of 20 over years, what we were doing, and how the grant was given, where was given, and stuff like that. So we found a few things that I thought it was needs immediate addressing. Number one, 99% of our funds went to non-certification courses. So that was a big glare thingy there. Number two, 40% of our grants went to team building. So non-productive, team building is important.
Different kind of productive.
Different kind of productivity.
It was a bonding productive, not a competence productive.
Yes, not a competency, not a core competence. So these two things we found out. So we started educating the market by telling them, look here, you need to emphasize on this. And another thing was the structure of HRDF fund was built for the last 23 years, where every ringgit the company puts in, they can take out a ringgit back. So whatever decisions made by the company, we just accepted then. It was on a micro level. So the company makes decision for themselves and not for the macro level or not for the nation building. If we compare with all the other countries in the world, Malaysia is the only country who has such a system. Every other country down south, Korea, Japan, any other countries you talk about, HRDF fund is treated as a pool fund. where the country decides, I mean the government decides on how do you, where do you want to put the money into training and how do you want to train people. And also we looked at whether the skilling process, whether it was right or not. Things like multi-skilling was not happening, reskilling was not happening. So how are we going to address these things? And also, we noted one thing, people talk about unemployment now these days, like you said, retrenchment and stuff like that. We started reading the trends, when we spoke to experts, we found out that retrenchment is not going to happen only in cyclical economic environment, it is going to happen when the industry changes. When the when new technology kicks in, there's going to be retrenchment going to happen. So the way we look at retrenchment must be changed. So to cater all this, we made a very tough decision. We said we want to annex 30% out of the
funds,
and we made it into a pool fund to address all these issues on ourselves. So
that
we decided that's one of the biggest change that we did, and everything else followed that. So we set up STCs, sectorial training committees, because we wanted to hear the voice of the industries. So sectorial training committees is headed by the private sector, the industry, and also is the whole thing is set up by them. We just became like a correspondent guy. I mean, we just become the secretariat. So whatever they wanted, we looked into it and we did it. So we mandated them to do training need analysis for the industry and come back to us and say, what do we need? Another thing what we did was we wanted to shift how the training providers think with the industry. So before this, it was a very much more supply driven industry. So I have this product, you have to get it from me. If you want something variant also, I cannot do that. You take this product, you think it differently. So that was how the industry was going. So we tried to set it around. We said it must be demand driven. So we let the industry to come and dictate what kind of things we want, and we gave a bit more incentive for the training providers to go towards that. So these are some big changes we did. Another thing is going online. So this is a question I always ask the trainer, like you go to the kids now these days, they look at YouTube, 20-30 seconds, they just switch. What makes you think that they'll sit down 8 hours and listen to you?
Absolutely.
So we need to change the way that, so online learning is something that we are trying to push. So these are three major things that we decided.
Okay. So those were the thrusts that, these are the thrusts.
Yes,
but
right.
I mean, if I look at HRDF, there's a lot of golden nuggets that are hidden, you know, that people don't quite understand. Tell us a bit about some of those things where, you know, you are actually helping the public and also helping different companies that we may be unaware about, you know, or certain things that you think that people don't really know about.
One of the, I think, underutilized segment funding that we have is on the disabled people. We call it OTAP. So we have a training, funding for training. If you want to train disabled people, I don't know whether the disabled is the right word to use or not. People with disabilities.
Yeah.
So whether they could be ADHD or they could have some kind of a mental thing,
learning disability, or physical Asperger,
can
be physical and can be also
mental. So we can have that. So we are telling the employers, if you have a position for them that you need them to go through special training, we will pay for the training. On top of that, just say you get someone who
and from your funds or from any funds?
It is from the pool fund. So we said
from the
pool fund, we give out that. And just say, you see, one is pool fund, the other one is the accumulated earnings that we have. So we usually divide and we try to give some from there. So then you are going to hire someone with a hearing disability. The siren goes off, he might not know that siren goes off. So you need to put a strobe light for the guy to understand. So those kind of things we can put. When I visited Japan, you walk on the staircase. Of course, Japan, they encourage you to take the stairs more than lift. I always complain about that, but nevertheless.
So that's good exercise. Helps your Fitbit.
Yeah. So when you hold the handrails, you notice there will be braille on the handrails. So it will tell you how many steps is there. After the step ends, whether it's going to right outside or going inside or you're going down, how many floors more. So all these things written. So that kind of thinking. And another thing, if you look at a lot of, again, Japan or Europe or something like that, when you go through the stair, there's usually a structure there done for you. So this kind of thinking that I think we need to infuse into the Malaysian HR culture, like not only talk about compensation and benefit, whether they are following the rules or not, but we need to be much more broader nowadays. So those kind of things. So OTAP is one of it. We have a program to bring rurals from outstation into urban and semi-urban areas. We support those kind of programs also. In fact, we have this program where we train the graduates up. That's something that we do constantly every year. unemployed fresh graduates who cannot get jobs, we give them some training so they'll be put into placement and stuff like that. And also we have a program where we train retrenched people to be re-employed again. So all these things, last time when we did this project, so we had a learning. Before this, we had some money, we did it. But we find that the training providers don't want to take the responsibility of placing them. So now we make it mandatory. We say that 30% of the money will be paid after the training. The other 70% is after the placement. So these are some of the differences.
So actually, there's an outcome that they have
They have to.
So let me end this little segment here with a couple of key questions. Two questions. So if I'm a fresh grad and I just graduated and I say I want to be like you, you know, I one day want to be a CEO of a government agency or a place that can impact the community or impact the nation. What advice would you give someone just graduating from university, just coming out to the workplace?
Swallow your pride.
Okay.
Swallow your pride and just do the job. When boss gives you to do something, just do it. Don't complain I'm being overworked and stuff like that, because every single job that you get is actually a learning curve for you. That's how I learned a lot of things also, from selling to repairing machines. So I can actually take out a photocopy machine, take it out, put it back in, I can repair those kind of things. But these are things that when I was doing sales, if I was thinking, why should I do this job? So I wouldn't learn it. So swallow your pride. I know you've been to the university. It's fantastic, pinnacle of your education system and stuff like that. But when you come out, it's a different reality. Especially kids nowadays, come out different reality. Just do whatever you can do, and I think that can give you a good experience.
Okay, that's great. And the last question: if you were addressing a group of CEOs, and you had to give them one piece of advice, what is that one nugget of wisdom that you'll impart?
Listen to your staff.
And sit down. You want to elaborate?
I think most of the time is because as a CEO, our time is very limited, because most of the time you'll be out and you'll be doing certain things and stuff like that. So you are one resource, but you have, like me, I have 300 over staff with me, which I have 300 different resources happening. So in a lot of times, I take a bit of my time, working time, to talk to my staff. It could be a simple chit-chat. It could be a serious discussion, maybe talking about what hobbies they have and stuff like that. And in a way, I'll always try to pry open what kind of ideas they can give you, because they're always very shy. Yep. Malaysians always got this problem. They don't want to blow their trumpet. They don't want to tell what abilities
so
you
really
have.
You must take the time.
Apart from making decisions, doing all the business thing, spend a bit of time, talk to your staff so you can get the best out of them.
Dr. Vic, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you.
Nice.
And thank you so much for your time.
Okay.
We're here on the Leaderonomics Show with Dato CM Vignaesvaran of HRDF.